be that aggressive and perspective that all this man would really not have been made to manage this, despite so many domain alternative sources that Lady manages. So I'm going to pick up one of the ladies from the audience and ask a question. Would any of you ladies volunteer to answer a question? So then, from our perspective, when you focus in terms of building the capability of managers, what do you genuinely believe are the ways in which we can build these capabilities that we're hearing this panel talk about, so that the enterprise is able to do performance management far more meaningfully?
I think the
digitization has to offer is that the biggest struggle is in cascading the rules at the senior-most level down to the lowest moment factor, if I may call that. Because the line of sight of the person right below there is more associated with the horizontal than the vertical, because it's more likely that the person works on a project with a team and shares the role with many others. But digitization, I think, offers an opportunity to get much more tactical and operational in terms of breaking down that role to the most minute part. And then the person reflecting on whether that has been achieved or not, like a game of golf, you're competing with yourself. So instead of someone breathing down your shoulder and being in a very hard and controlled atmosphere, the smartphone will tell you where you are.
Coming back to the panel discussion, another question we will take later on. This is how we will come to the open questions a little later on. This is the structured intervention we want to put in. So, bringing the question to you, of course, outlining the questions that I was discussing with you. We keep talking about culture being very, very critical. We keep saying that culture is a strategy for breakfast. Now, the question is that whenever we are talking about performance management systems, better technology, the normalization curves, we keep talking about all of these without the belief that culture is very, very critical in an enterprise. What may work in a multinational company may not necessarily work in an Indian enterprise. So is culture agnostic of the performance management system? Do performance management systems uniformly operate irrespective of what the culture is? So what is the role of culture?
I cannot have a particular type of communication or relationship when it comes to having my daily work. And I say, no, today I stage, today is a present day. Today we do this. And tomorrow and tomorrow. So I think the culture, whether you look at it in terms of openness, whether you look at it in terms of communication, for example, even in terms of these like transfer skills, I don't think it can be just for one process or some process. Culture is all about it. It will depend a lot in terms of all of these aspects look at the organization. Example in terms of senior level involvement, example in terms of technique feedback. For example, if there is a process by which managers know that after an approval process that they have the information, there is a feedback or a survey taken from all the employees in terms of various aspects of the performance. Now that's a very ongoing thing, and we use a lot of digitalization there to enable the process. Now, if this is something that is part of a culture, part of a process, some of these processes like the performance management or even engagement surveys, etc., are something that become very normal. Suddenly, implanting something which is totally not akin with the culture, I think gives a very different result or impact than what it would if it was part of an ongoing process, ongoing culture. So to summarize very clearly, I think the culture that prevails in an organization has an impact on the performance appraisal process. The performance appraisal process also is a part of the whole culture building process. So I think it's very, very important.
So for all these kind of new technologies where we are saying we are going to give feedback immediately, etc., etc., what are the possible interventions in the culture or the changes in the culture that will have to be brought about for any of these processes to succeed really? What do you feel about it?
I think at the...
You could answer it as well. Both of you can answer.
Actually build on what you said.
So we have an open culture, anyone can answer.
No, but at least once you talk.
Besides what Vineet has said, I think it's also very important to recognize whether a company has a team type of a culture or an individual type of culture. There's some organizations by nature need to perform in a team. Now, someone may throw the question, which organization is there that doesn't need to perform in teams? But there could be solo players where perhaps the individual matters more than the team. So where there is a team kind of culture, I think the appraisal system has to be a one type. perhaps celebrating to some extent the teamwork and so on. And you asked about how do you make it sharper, how do you make the system work. I think in a team kind of a culture where you have members who all have to row in the same direction and one tiller, I think it's important to have what the feedback on what the peers are saying. In a solo culture, it's much more what the superior is saying and what the person feels about his or her own contribution. So again, coming back to the point on digitization, it also increases your accountability, digitization, as to whether you're doing that appraisal process honestly or not, whether it's team or individual.
So Devu, let me come to you, and I'll come to you, Prashant, in a bit, because I also want you to give me a response to that. One of the biggest missing pieces in corporations when you talk to people is not whether the form was filled or not, not whether that thing happened or not. Was meaningful discussion around performance undertaken or not? And do you, at the end of the process, feel satisfied with the feedback given? The entire centrifugal force that drives the performance management is that crucial conversation between the manager and his associate around the domain of performance management, which is missing. How do you really ensure that this missing piece is put in place?
Over the last 5 years, I think it has become even more important that the conversation around performance is done in person and with the amount of time and energy that needs to go into it.
Evidence-based.
So if you look at most interactions these days is through email or text messages or through WhatsApp. You know, a manager and a subordinate tend to communicate digitally most of the time, and very few meetings or interactions which are in person. So if you do not have the performance conversation happening with the quality of one-on-one interaction and with the human element built into it, I do tend to agree with Yogi's viewpoint that digitization provides the data points or the facts, evidence-based element, but it also puts in place the importance of that human interaction, which now has even a far greater value because of the amount of digital interactions that we have. That's one. Second element is that we are seeing so many trends in the workplace, and I would like to share what one of our clients is doing right now is that they have completely disassembled the annual performance cycle into saying that we now only have quarterly plans and quarterly performance cycles. So from 5-year strategy, now people were talking about 3-year or 2-year strategy roadmaps. And they are saying that maybe the future lies in not even having a 1-year strategy roadmap, but strategy needs to shift quarter on quarter. So they are introducing a system where the quarterly plans are the ones that they work on, and the feedback and performance is evaluated on that. While they were doing this, the second realization that the client had is that how do we know that the goals that we are setting are, is the finite capacity that we are expecting from the people? Why can't we more like crowdsourcing is what are your aspirations? And they ran an experiment, and they realized that with the same business plan, if they asked individuals to aim for goals, which was asked of them saying that, what would you like to do this year? 3 things that you would like to focus on, and what are the goals you will take? The sum of that was far greater than what had been cascaded top down. So we are seeing that cascading goals top down is probably the source of all evils of a performance management system. But if you took a crowdsourcing mode, you are unleashing capacity from the people that you have. And believe me, younger people, typically older people, tend to be in the leadership role. Younger people have far more energy and passion to perform than probably what older people think from the wisdom that others can do. So fundamentally, there is a need for us to look at unleashing capability not only from the managers who manage performance, but also capability that exists within the organization right from the grassroots up, and see that what can we do, what kind of a performance can we create if everybody had the freedom to choose their zone of creative potential. The power is extremely high.
Correct. So that brings me back to what I told you in the beginning. The order of nature is balance. So it's not only the energy, but simultaneously the exposure and experience. And unless the two are balanced, no one will emerge a winner. Right? So that's good. Don't feel fossilized. Good. Now the question we have for you, Prashant, is that are we putting too much of a stress on the performance management system? We want the same process which is done currently once or maybe in future 5 times in the year. to do number one, differentiate the performer from the non-performer. We want to take decisions for compensation on that. We want to take decisions for rewards on that. We want to take decisions for training and development on the basis of the same system. So are we putting a huge amount of stress on the performance management system, making it do that one transaction or one episode of discussion, which generally is around 1.5 hours long, or not even that at times? Are we stressing the system so much that it finally can't even deliver one part of it effectively?
I completely agree with you that we cannot have everything linked to performance. While performance will form a very important criteria, but it can only be one of the criteria in a lot of things. So let's say variable pay. Variable pay perhaps can be completely linked to performance for that quarter, that month, that week, that day, that hour, I don't know how granular.
Business performance, not individual performance.
Granular, eventually it will go to, right? But whatever that time frame, but when it comes to increments, promotions, trainings, etc., we need to build, especially trainings and promotions, we need to build on, promotions could be about potential for the given performance. You can't promote a non-performer, but just because somebody has performed doesn't mean he can be promoted. It will be more about potential. Training should ideally be completely disassociated with performance, because somebody who's not performing perhaps need more training if he has the potential to perform. And therefore it is a question of building on people's strengths when it comes to training, when it comes to giving them new assignments or rotating them into different jobs, etc., etc., which should have very little to do with performance. And therefore, for each of these, if we have different sets of criteria and data sets, then there will be less anxiety about this whole performance management and getting, you know, classified into various buckets, etc., etc. And that's where people will realize that performance management is more of a business process, which gives them maybe variable pay, etc. But for rest of it, it could be one of the various inputs required. And that's what we need to achieve, to de-emphasize and kind of bring down the anxiety about this performance or the performance discussion.
Anyone in the audience having a TC card 2, TC 2, please raise your hands. Is there someone? Yeah. So would you like to ask question to Prashant on this entire aspect of overstressing the performance management system to deliver one too many things instead of focusing on one or two important things that it has to deliver?
Sir, I would like to make it a little more specific. That is because of my question. I want to ask about the manufacturing companies, which is basically the backbone for Indian economy, where 70 to 80% employees are workers. And maybe I'm talking about skilled or semi-skilled workers who do the same job year after year. Now, performance appraisal process, whether we talk about how it should be done, when it should be done, what is the intent of doing it, what are the outcomes of doing it, for a worker, which is 80-70% of my employee strength.
Tweet a question, please.
How do you motivate these people to focus on improving the quality of work rather than linking it to rewards? Because they have
these
a lot
of... five tweeters. One tweeter question, please.
Yeah, so for companies where you have limitations in terms of providing growth, in terms of role or money, how do you make PMS process effective for that set?
I mean, focusing on your worker population, which is what I guess your concern area, and how do we motivate them to deliver better performance. I think this is extremely classical example of using workers like some of the American automobile manufacturers use them as hands and legs, and one of them said that, I wonder why can't they keep their brains behind at home and come only with hands and legs, versus the Japanese auto companies who started valuing these suggestions, the experience of the workers. And that got them motivated to produce not only better quality, not only higher productivity, but come up with suggestions and come up with, you know, all that output of quality circle that happened that made Japanese auto majors, without naming anyone, on the whole, far superior to most of the world's automobile manufacturers and especially the American manufacturers. Right? So that is really the science and the art of motivating the workers.
Diversity and inclusion question. Come on, a lady to ask a question to anyone on the panel. Any lady to ask a question to any member on the panel.
I would like to ask a question. I'm Vandana Teji, and my question is to Debrata. And you know, talking about the latest trends in performance management, one of the big four companies has decided to actually segregate the bell curves for male and female population. What do you have to say?
So
gender is normal.
Yeah, segregation by gender is first of all a no-no. Okay, I think all are equal and there needs to be no segregation. And if you personally ask me, I'm not a big fan of this quota-driven approach to gender equality. It doesn't work. I think women are much smarter than men, and this is the only way we are trying to be unfair to them.
And we mix it up so that the men get protected.
But see, first of all, having two bell curves really doesn't solve the problem. Most importantly, having a bell curve doesn't solve the problem. The most important aspect is that, are you using a performance management system to take actions on it? And if you're waiting till the end of the year to slot people into a bell curve, you've lost the game completely. If you were to use, and I'll just use this as a very quick example. I tend to classify performance management system as the training wheels on bicycles. We give them to managers and the managers never learn to ride a bicycle. I keep telling my clients that take out the training wheels, make every manager fill up a single sheet every month. On one column, they have to write down the names of all the people that they lead who they think are not performing as per expectation. One column which people are performing as per expectation, and one column which is people performing far beyond expectations from them. And you need to now divide your time to have conversations with these people. Give a pat on the back to people who are on target. Spend some time with the superlative performers understanding what is it that they are doing differently, and spend 50% of your time on those people who are struggling to perform. You know, it's like my biggest lesson in leadership is about, as a parent, you don't abandon the child who's not scoring. You know, you actually ensure that you play the role of a leader and get the child to discover their passion or the area of performance, and that's the biggest good that you can do as a leader or a manager. We somehow tend to use it like a machine rather than actually using human interactions to drive it. So I would, whichever consulting firm that you talked about, I would actually encourage them to look at people from enhancing performance rather than classifying them into two separate.
Only one thing I'm sure, it's not your consulting firm. So that's
absolutely not.
Thank you for that question. Let's come back to the panel again. Vineet, we see that the system and the culture and the environment that we are talking about is becoming more and more open. We are coming into an environmental system where the associate and the manager do not really have that degrees of separation as they used to have in the good old days. They are more equals talking to each other. So on the one end, there is this openness that is coming. And on the other hand is a constant debate that's coming that we do not have a proper grievance handling process in the performance management. Oftentimes the main complaint that we keep hearing people telling us is, I don't agree with my boss's rating. We tried to debate it out, but we have not arrived at a conclusion. So desire on the one end of a system and a culture to be more open, and the other is existence of a contradictory appraisal. How do the two balance in a changing environment?
Okay. I think this is something that every organization has to look into, because increasingly, as you rightly said, maybe in the past 30-40 years, we have been talking about it was top down and what was given was taken. Times are changing and will change further. I think to my mind there are two, three things that have to be seen. One is, and as now you must have realized from the panel also, somehow most of this discussion is, while it is addressing the entire process of performance management, it should not get singled out only in the rating. And many of the articles or the quotes that come are all hinging around the rating part of it. So performance management is much beyond rating. I just thought I'd clarify that. Having said that, I think the feedback part, which either through digitalization or an app-based approach, is more frequent, even if it is not on an individual basis, is more frequent. So a dialogue process, a review process that I was talking of earlier also, is something that is a must. You cannot say that the present time is only after 6 months or 1 year. That would be part for a formal appraisal, which is perhaps mandatory by the law. But a review discussion, a feedback process will have to be continuous, and I think it will be something that as managers we'll have to get more used to. Because I think, as you rightly said, the newer workforce or the people today are going to ask for a feedback. And rightly so. If you are told of some sort of work that was done about 8 months back, memory would be poor on both sides, the manager and the employee. So I think for the manager also, it is useful to use that opportunity for a dialogue which is closer to the event rather than waiting for a, you know, structured way of doing it. Of course, it can be done at that time, but I think it will lose the relevance. Secondly, the point is that if you delay a process, the time for improvement or change course is hardly there. When you discuss in March or April, the year is over. So the employer says, what's the use of me coming to know about it today? Maybe at the right time I could have done some course correction there. Or if I'm doing something very well, how can I access it further? So these constant dialogue processes, I think, are a need. It is no longer a recommendation. I think it's a very major need today. The better it is done so that, you know, the angst or the sort of residual part is not left for you the last minute rating and review discussion that has been. The second thing is, yes, having said, having put process in place, the point that Adil is bringing about of a grievance or an issue would be there, and I think organizations have to, and many of us have provided for a mechanism where there is a reviewing manager or there is somebody whom the employee can go to and put forward the point. Because if we don't do it, a lot of grievances get pent up. They will take shape of many other dimensions. So it is better that there is a reviewing manager. There is someone who is there to at least listen and pay attention to an issue if it is there. Some of the issues may be genuine, some of them may not be genuine. But at least we have to have some process mechanism in place so that the employee knows that my career or my appraisal is not dependent on a person alone. It's an organization that I'm working for and not a particular organization.
So Yogi, in large organizations like yours, appraisals don't happen in series, they happen parallelly. So, you know, some people are doing it, their subordinates are also doing appraisal of their teams, their bosses are doing appraisals of their people and things like that. So the entire organization is kind of going through the entire process of doing appraisals. You don't know who at which point of time comes, and it comes to a conclusion that the manager of the appraisal is a non-professional. Right? So he's gone around doing appraisals of his people, and subsequently at a point of time, that manager's boss actually declares that manager as a not so great performer, an incompetent performer. How do you manage that kind of a reality in an enterprise? Because that's a kind of complaint that one keeps coming across very often, that I think my manager himself is a non-performer. How come he is rating my performance?
One is that any appraisal process or performance management system should have a domino effect. That means that while it may happen in parallel or series, the example has to be set right on top. And if people at the top are doing their job well, then it flows down even to this manager or who is supposed to be a non-performer. Now, our discussion so far, I have a feeling, has more or less been confined to the Indian subcontinent. If we go to a little bit of a different kind of a geography, like say the Western world, I think it's extremely important, since you're talking about non-performers, to document the entire conversation, to document it and get agreement on what has transpired between both the manager as well as the SS, the person who's got assessed. And I think the judgment on performance or non-performance is not very material when the question of feedback comes, because that person is giving a feedback to a person who has performed under him or not performed under him in a particular context. Now, if we feel that is colored, if the reviewing officer or the reviewing committee feels it's colored in our context, since you asked about my organization, if we see that the appraisal score is dropping dramatically by 2 points, we have an 8-point appraisal system. Let's say a person has got rated 6 in the year number 2015-16 and suddenly drops to 4. If the appraisal score is dropping that drastically, it goes by default to something called a macro view group. And then the macro view group is supposed to implement. But to come back, I think it's very important to document the conversation that's happening. It's very important that even if the person is a non-performer, you respect what the person is saying. And if you feel that the person is incompetent to doing the appraisal, is so incompetent, first of all, I'd like to ask, why has the person arisen to that level at all? And then
it is only after coming to that level they have found that he's incompetent.
Maybe in performing his roles, but not perhaps in doing the performance conversation on ratings. They're two different issues.
Sure.
So that's what